blessed be your name. When the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. On the road marked with suffering, but there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say.
Welcome to Smithville, brethren. Good to have you here this morning. A couple of things I want to share with you. The first is we've got a listing in the bulletin that says World Communion Sunday is October 4th. So in the brethren tradition, we've typically had communion services twice during the year, October, beginning of October, and then right around Easter time, the Thursday before Easter. We were not able to have our Easter communion service because of COVID. We were thinking about what could we do to have communion during the time, you know, October. And so what we're going to do is next week, we're actually going to have the service focused on communion, and we're going to actually take the bread and the cup communion, kind of that part of it, in the service. So when you come in next week, you're going to get a little cup with a wafer packaged on top of it. It is not the homemade communion bread, of which the recipe I can't share with you because it's a deeply held secret here in the Brethren Church. It will be a wafer, so please do not expect what you get at communion if you've been to communion in that package. It is not ours, but anyway, you'll get one of those, and we're going to focus on communion and what it means and talk about the other parts of communion and then be able to take the bread and the cup. Now, if you've been part of another church where they do that weekly or quarterly or monthly or whatever, that will feel very normal to you. If you've been a part of the Brethren Church for a long time, that's going to feel very strange. We don't typically do that in that way, but that's what we're going to be doing next week. Also, I wanted to share with you that Donna Rulon, who is a regular part of our first service since we started the outdoor service, she and her husband have been coming to our outdoor service. Donna had a stroke on Wednesday, so she had some trouble with her eyesight, right eye. Been figured out that it's actually from a stroke. So she's in the hospital, and she will be hopefully discharged soon. She's in really good spirits. I spoke with her yesterday, but we can be in prayer for her that she would recover from that. So let's pray. Father, thank you that you are in charge. We ask for your work to be done as we plan and look forward to celebrating communion next week. Be with us as we do that, but we with Donna as she is wrestling with the effects of the stroke, and ask that you would just bring healing to her body, whether you use the doctors and nurses and medications or you just miraculously intervene and heal it. Either way, Lord, we would love to see her be able to have restored eyesight in the periphery of her vision so that she might be able to return to normal kinds of activities, Lord. Bless them and hold them. In Jesus' name, amen.
Worthy of all our praises, Hosanna.
Lord's Day, we're gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. Descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now. Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing.
Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, the mighty river flowing from your heart and filling.
Worthy of every breath we could.
lift you up. We praise you. You're the foundation that we stand upon, so we cannot be shaken. You are who you are, and we love you for it. We thank you for being able to gather once again for another week, as we know these times are uncertain what's going to happen next. Lord, we love you. We praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Following is hard work, folks. People want to be leaders, and they want to be out front and make decisions. I mean, some people do. But to be a great leader, you have to be a great follower. We've seen this through the pattern of Joshua's life as we've exposed ourselves to Joshua in the last number of weeks. Joshua was a great leader, but he first was a great follower. And God would tell him to do something, and he would in turn tell the people to do it, and they would do it. And that's great followership. And so the people began to listen to Joshua and follow him, and he was their leader. But following God is not always easy. It's not always simple. We're going to look at a few things this morning from Joshua 10. If you've got your Bible, you can turn there. I'm going to read a bit of Joshua 10 to you. And like you do probably when you read it, I'm going to stumble through these kings' names and be thankful that we're not reading later in the book where there's tons of names. So just follow along with me. This is Joshua chapter 10. And now, Adonai Zedek, king of Jerusalem, heard that Joshua had taken Ai and totally destroyed it, in doing to Ai and its king what he had done to Jericho and its king, and all that the people of Gibeon had made a treaty of peace with Israel had become their allies. He and his people were very much alarmed at this, because Gibeon was an important city like one of the royal cities. It was larger than Ai, and its men were good fighters. So remember, not last week, but the week before, we talked about this treaty that was made between the Gibeonites and Israel. The Gibeonites tricked the Israelites into making the treaty, claiming they were from a long way off, and they made the treaty with them under false pretenses. But they made the treaty nonetheless. What we're going to see in this chapter is that the Israelite people are not just going to uphold a piece of the treaty that says, we're not going to kill you, but they're also going to come to their aid. So what we're going to read about here is this group of kings that gets together to fight against the Gibeonites. So Adonai Zedek, king of Jerusalem, appealed to Hoham, king of Hebron, Piram, king of Jarmuth, Japhia, king of Lachish, and Debir, king of Eglon. Come up and help me attack Gibeon, he said, because it has made peace with Joshua and the Israelites. Then the five kings of the Amorites, the kings of Jerusalem, Hebron, Jarmuth, Lachish, and Eglon, joined forces. They moved up all their troops and took positions against Gibeon and attacked it. Verse 6, the Gibeonites then sent word to Joshua at the camp at Gilgal, do not abandon your servants. Come up to us quickly and save us, help us, because all the Amorite kings from the hill country have joined forces against us. So Joshua marched up from Gilgal with his entire army, including all the best fighting men. The Lord said to Joshua, do not be afraid of them. I have given them into your hand. Not one of them will be able to withstand you. After an all-night march from Gilgal, Joshua took them by surprise. Then the Lord threw them into confusion before Israel. So Joshua and the Israelites defeated them completely at Gibeon. Israel pursued them along the road going up to Beth Horon and cut them down all the way to Ezekah and Makkedah. As they fled before the Israelites on the road down from Beth Horon to Ezekah, the Lord hurled large hailstones down on them. More of them died from the hail than were killed by the sword. On the day the Lord gave them the Amorites over to Israel, Joshua said to the Lord in the presence of Israel, sun stand still over Gibeon, and your moon over the valley of Alajun. So the sun stood still, and the moon stopped, till the nation avenged itself on its enemies, as it is written in the book of Jashar. The sun stopped in the middle of the sky and delayed going down about a full day. There has never been a day like it before or since, a day when the Lord listened to a human being. Surely the Lord was fighting for Israel. Here's the first thing I want us to catch from this passage. Following the Lord means facing battles. When we read this account, we know that God has given the promised land to the people of Israel. He's already told them. 400 years prior, he made the promise, and now that promise is being lived out in the acquisition of the actual land that is the promised land. But there have already been battles. There was the Battle of Jericho, fought in an odd way. There was the Battle of Ai, fought in a more conventional way. And in chapter 10, more battles. What we see is God has promised the land to the people, but he's not just handing them a deserted or abandoned land. He's not just giving them up open real estate, but he is causing them to be a part of these battles in order to take the land. Now, in our lives, we don't face battles like this typically unless we serve in the active military. We're not really battling against an enemy in the same way, but we do face battles. And when we follow the Lord, we will follow battles in our life. We will have them. At some point, you will face the battle of aging. This is when our mind is able, but our body is weak. I was thinking of you this week, Scott, and thinking, I just installed an electric trailer jack on my trailer. He and I had discussed how we weren't old enough to do that yet. I am now. You have my permission. Right? A while back, we were cleaning out the lamb pen at my house, and we stuck a shovel in what I'll just describe as the matted bedding material. If you grew up on a farm, you know exactly what I'm talking about. If you did not, be thankful I will not explain what that is or show you pictures. But I went to dig in to the matted bedding material, and I turned, and my back kind of... And for a week, I walked in kind of a strange way. It didn't last a super long time, but it was inconvenient. And I thought to myself, I've never done anything like that. People talk about, straaining their back. It's never happened to me. But there it was. It's happening. My eyes are not what they used to be. And I think that in the not too distant future, my hair might turn gray. Signs of aging. Our bodies were not meant to last forever on this earth. We will battle that. We will battle the sort of deterioration of our capacities once we hit adulthood. Kids, you know, they're at the other end. They're growing and developing and able to do more and more. And sometime, at some point, we sort of finish that course and we begin to head the other direction, and it's a battle. And then there's the serious calls that we get from the doctors that show a shadow or a lump or a growth or a unknown thing, and now we're battling a disease that we never knew we had, and now we're aware of it, and so we have to do all that we can do to prevent the progression of the disease and maybe push it back or cure it or heal it or hold it off or whatever. We face these things. These battles, they're real in our lives. Some of us are going to battle injuries. Some injuries, like my back injury, lasted a week. It's not a big deal. Others, they battle longer-term injuries. Sometimes it's a season-ending injury. Sometimes it's a multi-year process before they get any kind of healing or relief or restoration of the ability to do the things that they've been able to do. Along the way, these battles can cause us to also battle discouragement and disappointment. God tells Joshua at the front end of this, the very beginning of the book, be strong and courageous. He relays that to the people of Israel at this point, to be strong and courageous. Why? Because they're facing battles which require strength, and they're facing difficulties that require courage. Courage to stand in, courage to stand up, courage to face whatever it is we are facing in this life. When we follow the Lord, we will face battles. We might be battling against the strains of caring for our aging parents and the struggles they're experiencing. Or we're battling at the other end. I can vividly remember trying to get Rebecca to go to sleep when she was little. This was a battle. Thankfully, we don't have that battle anymore, I don't think. Whatever it is, you will face difficulties. A few weeks back, I spoke about the internal battles we struggle. We struggle against the pull of the culture, the enticement of sin. These things battle against us. And we will need to engage in these battles. But there's another thing I want us to catch, and that is following the Lord means working with him. We've learned in reading about Joshua and the conquest of the promised land that God, even though he promised the land, again, is not just handing the land to them. They're working to be a part of acquiring the land. A number of years ago, our family, as many of you know, we decided we would take a westward trip. And we would take our travel trailer. And so I got thinking about the vehicle I was using to tow the trailer and decided, I don't think it's going to be up to the job. So I started looking for another one. A friend of mine called me and said, hey, I know someone who has four of the same vehicle. Four of them. And he might want to sell one. So I called him up. He said, actually, I want to get rid of all of them. Well, I don't need all of them. So I went down and looked at them. I drove two of them. One you couldn't drive because it had no engine. So anyway, so I drove them, two of them. We got back to his house. He said, do you like this one? I said, yeah, this one looks pretty good. And he had told me ahead of time the price he wanted for them and wasn't quite sure, but something to think about. And he said, well, here's the deal. I like what you do, and I think what you do is important, and I want to bless you, so I want to give you this vehicle. I said, you can't do that. He said, yeah, I can. It's mine. I can give it to you. So Jennifer and I talked it over later. This is a real blessing. I mean, it needed a few things, right? It needed a hitch and tires and front end parts, meaning the stuff that you, when you turn your steering wheel, there's stuff that has to turn. If that stuff doesn't work right, you can't actually drive the car down the road. It needed some of that stuff. All stuff, no big deal. Oh, and it needed an engine. I forgot. It needed an engine, right? The promised land, God says, I'm going to give you this land. By the way, it's occupied with people who are not ready to give it up, right? You get to work with the Lord. What you are doing is something beyond just a gift like a Christmas gift where someone hands it to you, you unwrap it, and you're like, oh, cool. No, you're going to be working with it. You're going to be doing things. It is a surprise, perhaps, and it's actually a privilege that God allows us to work with him, alongside of him. Following the Lord is not a spectator sport. Right? Some of you will go home and watch some NFL football. Some of you have already told me you're going to go home and do this, right? And you're going to sit on your couch or in your chair and you're going to watch the game and you might be with people and you're going to critique and criticize what the quarterback is doing and what the defensive coordinator does and the play caller and the coach and everybody else and the officials, of course. But you're not going to get off your couch, right? You're not going to be holding the ball after it gets snapped to you with multi-hundred pound men charging at you with one desire in their eyes to snap you in two. It won't be you. You'll be on your couch. Maybe you'll be complaining it's a little cold or a little warm and you can go to the thermostat and change your temperature, but you will not be on the field. Following the Lord is not a spectator sport. He doesn't ask us to be on the sideline and just sit and watch and wait. He calls us to be a part of it. And he says to Joshua and the people of Israel, here is the land I'm giving you. Now go get it. Go engage in the battle in the way I'm going to tell you to do it. But go engage in the battle. We believe that God will provide for us. One of the main ways God will provide for you financially in your life is to give you the ability, capacity, and so forth to work. Work precedes the fall. It's a very important thing for us to know. Before the fall of Adam and Eve, God said that there would be work. The frustration of work is a result of the fall, but the skills we have, the time we have, the experience we have, the opportunities we have is a main way in which God provides for us. I grew up in a Catholic home, Irish Catholic home. More of the Irish is what I want to talk about. We did not sit around wondering where the leprechauns were and the pots of gold. That was not a strategy, right? My parents didn't say to me, hey, we're Irish. Leprechauns will be on our side. There'll be a pot of gold. Just hang out. Wait. No, doesn't work that way. We're to be involved and to be active and so forth. Sometimes we have to work beneath our abilities and skills just to survive. Sometimes we need to work extra long or an extra job to move ahead and get out of debt or deal with something that has come our way. All of it requires our participation. That's the point. Do you want to be spiritually mature? Do you want to grow in your faith? Well, growing in your faith requires work on your part. It's part of God's design. It's part of his will. It is not instant. Maturity is not instant or automatic. You didn't decide to be a follower of Christ and God said, you are now perfectly holy and completely done. You are never going to sin again. You will never be tempted again. Every area of your life will be 100% worked out. Every relationship you've ever had will be perfectly made new and everything will be wonderful from this day forward. You will not have any battles or troubles or anything else because you are 100% mature, and what a glorious thing will be. All you got to do is find the perfect church, which is full of imperfect people, and you discover maturity is not instant. Do you want a great marriage? It requires work on your part. It's part of God's design, part of his plan. He wants you to have a great and fulfilling marriage, but it requires work. It is not instant. It is not automatic. When a couple gets married, and we got a couple getting married soon, when they get married, I'm not going to tell them at the end of the ceremony, you're done. It's over. No more work. I know you've been working hard to, you know, to get a date with her, and I know you worked hard to, you know, build that relationship, and I know you've been thinking about what you're doing and compromising and making good decisions, but now you're done. It's over. You're instantly married. You're perfect. You never have to work at this ever again. I will not say that to them, because good marriage takes work. God calls us to participate in those things that he's giving us. You want to be a great athlete? You want to be a great athlete? Do great athletes just sit around and watch game film and eat popcorn? Right? Is it a spectator sport? No. They're involved. They're disciplining themselves, their mind, their body, their sleep, their eating habits, the training that they do, all of those things. They participate in it, right? What I'm getting at is when we follow the Lord, we don't just wait around for him to work. We are a part of it. God calls us to be actively involved in moving forward. Additionally, following the Lord means seeing him work. Think back over the rest of the book. We got the crossing of the Jordan River. And when we read about it, God's plan is not this. He doesn't call Joshua to him and say, oh, Joshua, come to the place and let me speak to you. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to cross the Jordan River, but here's what we got to do. We got to call the state inspectors. We got to call the Corps of Engineers, the Army Corps of Engineers, and we got to get them out so that we can design and build a super dam. And we're going to dam up the water here, and then it'll be dry here, and then you'll cross over, and then we'll release the water from the dam, it'll be back to normal. Is that what Joshua says, beginning of Joshua? No, nothing like that, except the water gets stopped. And the water gets stopped because God does it. He says, you know, you get the priest, get the ark, get them in the water. As soon as they hit the water, bam, it's going to stop. You're going to see me intervene in a way you cannot explain away. Same thing with Jericho. Here's the strategy. Run around the city. City walls are going to fall after you blow your trumpets. Insanely crazy kind of military strategy. But what does it do? It demonstrates God is doing something. And no one can explain away what he is doing because he's the only one who could make that work. When we follow the Lord, we will get to see God intervene. We'll get to see God do amazing things. Places that we'll get to see amazing things that God does. There's a prayer request, right, in the middle of this. But before that, here's what we see. The battle ensues, and what does God do? God says, the passage says that he threw the enemy into confusion, right? You know what it means to be thrown into confusion, right? And I don't know what to do. I don't know where I'm going. And then he threw hailstones at him. And apparently it's a good shot because more people died from the hailstones than the sword. Right? So they're participating, they're doing, they're obeying, they're following God's instructions. They are the hand of judgment in this time for these people, but God is also doing things that only God can do, right? How many of you can throw hailstones? I mean, I guess you could try to pick one up and chuck it, but I mean, from the sky, can you do that? No, you cannot. And then there's a prayer request. The prayer request is this. It's simple. Joshua says he wants the sun to stand still. Now, if you've ever traveled to Alaska, you know that feels like that's what's happening. You look at your watch, you think, oh my, I should go to bed. It's late, but it's still bright out. And then you look at your watch 5 hours later, and you think, I really should go to bed, and it's still bright out. But that's not where they were. This is a place where when the sun stands still, as the scripture records, for almost an entire day, it is a miraculous intervention of God. And what is God up to? Some commentators say, look, Joshua is in the middle of the battle, and the people are fleeing, and so basically God leaves the lights on. Joshua asks for it, right? You ever have a snowball fight at your house in the waning, into the darkness? I don't recommend this, by the way. It can hurt when you get hit in the head. You don't even see it coming. But if someone turns the lights on that are going outside the house, that'd be, you know, you could go a little longer. The battle can continue because God says, I'm going to leave the lights on. And I'm going to let this happen. God shows up and God does amazing things in the midst of all of this. So following him means you get to see. Every time we pray, every time we lift someone up, Every time we pray for a situation or something happening in our community or in our society or our world, in our country, whatever, we have the opportunity to see God intervene. Whether we pray for our son's pig because it's lame and doesn't want to get out of its bed in order to go to the fair, or whether we pray for somebody to be healed or a relationship to be restored, God will move and can move. We can see it in our church family. We can see it in the world. We can see it in our community. Recently, at our most recent official board meeting, we invited an individual in to share his story and to talk about the ministry he's involved in. And we started, I think, with just one question, and I think he took a breath about a half hour later. And he just was telling us about how God met him in the midst of his life, like what his life was like before the Lord, how God met him, and what that meant in terms of the ministry he's involved in now. And it was one thing after another that was just a clear evidence of God showing up and doing things that God does. You'll get a chance to hear from him, I think, very soon. In the next number of weeks, I think we'll try to get him here so that you can hear his stories. But I think the board could have listened for an additional hour. I don't know that the board has ever had a conversation that's gone on where people are sitting around thinking, I could listen for another hour. Usually they're looking at their watches thinking, I should be in bed. But God was at work and doing amazing things in and through this man's life. And he was giving us just the highlights. Like, we didn't even get all the stories. We just got some of them. If you're going to follow the Lord, you're going to get to work with him, alongside him, but you're also going to see him do amazing things. And we can see that in this passage, and we can see that in our lives. Here's the final thing I want us to catch, and that is, when you're following the Lord, it means cleaning out your cave. Now, this is a part of the story we didn't read. Here's what goes on. The five kings decide that they already know what's gone on prior in Ai and in Jericho, and they know what's happened to those kings. So they devise this plan to gather together all five of them to go attack Gibeon, because Gibeon has made this treaty with Israel. So there they go. They go off. They're going to attack. They start the battle, and the battle begins, and they're beginning to lose the battle. It's very clear it's not going their way. And so what happens, this is a loose Hebrew translation. I think they gathered together, and they went, ah! I think that's what it says. And they go, and it says, if you read further ahead, it says the five of them do what good leaders do. They ran away. Right? They just took off. Ah! And they run off and they hide in a cave. And all they're doing is trying to save their own skin at that point. They're not leading anymore. They're not concerned with their nation. They're not concerned with their people. They're concerned with themselves. And they run off and they hide in this cave. And then Joshua, it says, finds out about the five kings going off to the cave. And Joshua is under orders from God to take care of, to wipe out all of the people. These five kings would be included in that. And he's been faithfully moving through that for the most part. So he has his people close the cave off. They seal it off with stones. And then later he goes back, opens up the cave, they bring out the five kings, and they kill them. So the kings could have been a future threat to Joshua and the people of Israel, but he deals with them. And that's what happens. Now, I want you to think about this cave for just a moment. The cave for the five kings is a place of refuge. They're running there to save their own skin. They're running there thinking that they'll be able to preserve their life, extend their life, whatever. And so they go off to this cave. But once it gets sealed, the refuge becomes a prison. Now they can't get out. And ultimately, one writer says, ultimately their imprisonment becomes their place of demise or doom. So I want us to think about this in more spiritual terms and beyond just the story, the account, but think about what people turn to essentially rescue themselves. Think about what people turn to sort of fix themselves. I'll give you one example to start with. Sometimes when life is difficult, we turn to things like drugs and alcohol. You know, whether it's physical pain or emotional pain, difficulty in relationships, whatever it is, we turn to these things and we think these are going to provide some level of relief. In fact, we see that depicted often. You know, oh, it's been a hard day. What do you need to do? Go get a drink. I remember, how many of you are old enough to remember, and I can't even see you, so it doesn't matter, but old enough to remember the show Dallas? Yeah. So Dallas, one of the things they did perpetually, they pumped a lot of oil and they drank a lot of alcohol, right? They would come home and they would just pour all kinds of stuff and they'd constantly be drinking. Oh, tough day, right? When people turn to alcohol and drugs, And they think it's going to be something that will rescue them from the pain of their lives. It very rapidly becomes their prison. And they're caught in it. And ultimately, it can be the doom of their lives. It can be their destruction. We live in a society that is full of opioid abuse. We constantly read about people who have died because of overdose. Not because they probably in many cases wanted to, but because they accidentally did. And they've turned their lives over to this thing they think that will be their savior or their rescuer or their alleviator of pain and trouble. And it has become their prison and their doom. And that story has been told over and over and over. And it's not just people that you might imagine. It's not just people that look a certain way. It's not just people who are of a certain socioeconomic class. It cuts through all of that. And the very thing we run to becomes the thing that will destroy us. We can do that with all manner of things. We can think about, it's a tough time in my life, and so what do I want to do? I want to therapeutically shop. I'm going to alleviate the pain I feel or the boredom I feel or the disappointment I feel. I'm going to go buy something new. And by the way, when we do that, we never buy nobody ever says, man, it was a bad day, and what's going to give me a real pickup? I think I'll go buy a head of lettuce at Bueller's. Nobody does that. No. No, you buy a pair of shoes or, a super cool vehicle or whatever. I mean, so the thing we think is going to save us, the thing we think is going to rescue us, the thing we think is going to alleviate our pain for the short term, or maybe we're even convinced it'll be long term, even though it never is, then becomes maybe our financial prison. Maybe it becomes the thing that sucks us in and holds on to us and really becomes to make our lives more and more difficult. When we seek to eliminate pain and trouble in our lives from something other than the Lord himself, they can become our prison and our doom. And it doesn't matter what we pick. It doesn't matter whether it's drugs and alcohol or entertainment or sexual involvement or something else. And it may be slowly or it may be dramatically, they become our trap and our undoing. So there's an ad that's on TV, you know how it goes, and there are various versions of it, but the tagline is, what's in your wallet, right? You know that one. So let me ask you, what's in your cave? What's in your cave? What's the nature of your cave? What do you got in there that you need to clean out? Joshua knew the five kings were in there. Joshua knew that God's order was not to let anybody live. Joshua went and took care of it. What do you got to take care of in your life? Because following the Lord is the best thing that you can do. And it'll be full of battles. It'll be full of adventure. It'll be full of participation in the things that you get to do and the things you get to watch God doing. But it will be undermined by our own caves. Father, thank you that you love us so much, that you call us to live a life that is full of obedience to you, because that is the best way to live. So Lord, help us to obey you in every way. As we see Joshua in this case obeying you, help us to follow you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Separate us now.
What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. Torn before you, you silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Father, we thank you for the name of Jesus, that we can celebrate all that you have done for us and through us, and all that we expect to happen in the future, Lord. Bless us as we leave this place, that we might follow you. In Jesus' name.